यस सर, वी कैन सी योर स्क्रीन।
ओके, दैट्स फैंटास्टिक। सो नेक्स्ट 20 मिनट्स आई विल बी टॉकिंग ऑन एनहांस्ड मायोनिटरी वैस्कुलैरिटी। आई सब डॉक्टर अजित। Just hold on, because I think the share is from the. Okay, that's fine. So no disclosures, and I am thankful to Dr. Sandeep Pansare and Dr. Sandeep Kothrade, both of them they invited Christian Doppler because we are all speaking about Doppler during the our talks. During my entire talk of 20 minutes, disclosure is that I have attributed a few articles. Which the content of which have been given published. One is geological and histological imaging features in subsequent products of conception. The next one is ultrasound diagnosis management of acquired uterine enhanced myometrial vascularity. The third one is standardization of peak systolic velocity measurement in enhanced myometrial vascularity. And the other two are pertaining to the management and diagnosis of related products of conception as well as enhanced myometrial vascularity. So these are the things which I want to disclose. Next 20 minutes we will be discussing about appearances of related products of conception, how does the spectrum varies on grayscale ultrasound and color Doppler. Then what is enhanced myometrial vascularity per se and how do you assess the same, and why it is important from treatment protocols. So what are the treatment guidelines? And we'll discuss about a few of the cases. One of two are quite interesting one. So whenever there is a post-MTP situation wherein there is a product of conception or enhanced myometrial vascularity, there's a 10-point protocol which we need to follow, starting from surface contour, endometrial thickness, whether it is increased with abnormal vascularity or without, content of the endometrial vascularity in terms of simplicity or complexity, presence or absence of endometrial enhanced vascularity, and the other features like adnexal complex lesion, pelvic collection, rod ligament lesions like hematomas, and areas in the bowel loops or urinary bladder region or collection within the pelvis which is extending up above into the Morrison's house and parapelvic spaces. Always important for us to remember that whenever we are evaluating any MTP situation, we need to categorize the situation that what is a grade of severity in terms of findings that we see on ultrasound and color Doppler. There were many people who started working on products of conception appearances on ultrasound and color Doppler, and most of them they stated that there are two categories. One is the endometrial thickness abnormality increased. Secondly is complexity of endometrial content and its relativity in terms of appearance of vascularity or not. So there were different studies which were elaborated in radiographics, one of the journal. So whenever we say intent products of conception, we say that endometrial complex thickening is there, which is more than 10 millimeter. The cavity content,
Sorry to interrupt. Actually, can you be little louder?
I am disconnecting the earphones. Just let me know whether it is audible or not.
Hello?
Yes, sir.
Am I better?
Yes, sir, it is better.
Okay. So, retained products of conceptions. The primary change could be endometrial eco complex thickening, which is more than 10 millimeter, with or without presence of vascularity. Cavity content in terms of complexity. So it could be a simple, say, anechoic collection within the endometrial cavity, which is increasing in terms of complexity. So that is the second one. And the vascularity. So the vascularity could be within the content of the endometrial cavity or within the adjoining junction zone of endometrial region or in the myometrial region. So these are the things. So here you can see it's an interrupted endometrial cavity fluid collection because of the membrane. here there is echogenic content within the endometrial cavity, which is because of the hemorrhagic collection within the same. Here the complexity has grown further, wherein there is a mass-like appearance along with lot of heterogeneity within the endometrial content, and the next could be there is a pseudomonas appearance within the endometrial cavity, which is causing ballooning of the endometrial cavity. The next would be a mass appearance within the endometrial cavity, which is causing expansion of the endometrial cavity into the adjoining structure, and with or without presence of the vascularity within the endometrial cavity content or expanding beyond the endometrial cavity content into the myometrial region. So this is the entire spectrum of RPOC, ranging from simple fluid collection within the cavity to a complex collection or a lesion or a mass within the cavity with or without presence of an abnormal vascularity. So with an appropriate clinical history of missed menses or MTP, presence of a thickening of endometrial leukocomplex or endometrial complexity mass or a pseudomass with a detectable vascularity within that content, which is extending beyond that content, could be a feature of RPOC. So we are discussing about RPOC and not enhanced myometrial vascularity. So this is a myometrium, this is an endometrium. So whenever there is a no flow, the vascularity type is type 0. When the flow is less than the myometrial flow, then it is a type 1 flow. When the type 2 or type 3 flow, which you can see that the flow is equal or more than the vascularity of the myometrium. So these are pertaining to the RPOCs within the endometrial cavity, different types of flow. So Van de Bosch stated and coined the term enhanced myometrial vascularity based on the color Doppler examination of the uterus, and most of these findings were attributed to pathological conditions in which there were retained products of conception. What it is exactly? A tangle of tortuous blood vessels having multidirectional status, high velocity turbulent flow. The baseline velocity which has been attributed is 20 centimeters per second. So any velocity which is more than 20 centimeters is abnormal. So usually most of them, they have a history of early pregnancy events, either normal or abnormal passage of products of conception or intervention, and all the changes in terms of EMV are similar in cases of patients presenting with caesarean section scar pregnancies treated with MTX. So these are the different appearances of enhanced myometrial vascularity. So this is a patient in which there is a post-mesoperous feature. This is post-DNC in cases of non-viable 11 weeks pregnancy. And this is a post-DNC in cases of a gestational topoplasmic disease. So here, there is no much vascularity in endometrial content, but there is a branching vascularity which is extending into the myometrial zone. Here, there is a vascularity within the endometrial content also extending beyond its content, and here there is appearance similar to that of mass which is extending beyond it, and there is variable degree of vascularity in terms of PSV which we can calculate very well by quantifying the same. We always should remember that whatever we are dealing with is for vascularity of endometrial content or endometrial content extending into the myometrial junction. So we should always ignore the subserosal increased vascularity which is occurring because of pelvic sepsis or some or the other trivial intervention in the pelvic space. So here you can see that there is increased vascularity in subserosal space which is also extending beyond the uterus into the adnexal zone. This is nothing but a pelvic congestion syndrome in which the cause more or less is a sepsis. But always we need to understand that when we do any kind of intervention within the uterus because of instrumentation of medical drugs, we can get a subserosal vascularity. At the same time, we need to see what are the changes in the endometrial cavity. here you can see there is a little bit of complexity within the endometrial cavity because of products of conception, and there is some degree of vascularity which is extending from the endometrial cavity into the biometrial junction. So we need to understand the same. On grayscale ultrasound, the findings are non-specific, like presence of irregular hypoechoic or anechoic channels, which are tortuous in nature, which are tubular in nature, which are within the myometrial substance, but mostly always adjoining to the endometrial hypocomplex. Whenever we think in terms of color doctor, we need to always do a proper settings of equipment so that we can assess the vascularity quantitatively in a better fashion. So gain, balance, PRF and velocity need to be addressed in a proper fashion. Always remember, whenever you have 3D color Doppler or a power Doppler angiogram in your equipment, should be always freely used, because that gives an additional support to your level of confidence, stating that it's a enhanced myometrial vascularity. So what are the Doppler settings? Usually we are quite familiar with the Doppler settings of infrared in the patient, in which the settings were described by Rain and Fanning in 2002. So the same setting can be used. So endometrial receptivity index settings can be used, but we should always remember that the PRF of one, power Doppler of four, color gain of 38.4 and in and around, and other features, we need to extend it to endomyometrial junctional and endomyometrial increased vascularity features. So what is it actually? It is nothing but a three-step approach, in which on a grayscale ultrasound, we take a panoramic view which contains the uterus and the endometrial content and a Doppler focusing on a suspicious area of the RBOCs. The next thing what I need to do is I have to tackle with the PRF. So PRF should be gradually increased so that the reverberation artifacts or the color artifacts are reduced and only a few prominent dominant vessels are noted. The highest and the correct PSV noted after correction of PRF should be measured by using narrow sample volume of 1 millimeter. So these are the three things which I need to consider, which is called a three-step approach, and I need to calculate the velocity of enhanced myometrial lesions. The guideline, why this velocity is important, is because there are certain guidelines which are attributed to the peak systolic velocity that we encounter. So we have less than 40 centimeter velocity, which is considered a safe zone, in which the patient can be reasonably followed up on ultrasound itself or depending upon the clinical scenario of the patient. If the velocities are between 40 to 60, the expected treatment in terms of medical management for bleeding PV or assisted management can be taken. But whenever the velocities are more than 60, per se the red flag zone is 80 centimeter per second, then definitely we should give attribution to the clinical factors as well as the peak systolic velocity, for which the treatment could be a uterine artery embolization or the further course. But whenever the velocity is more than 100 centimeters per second, the other modalities of treatment could be total abdominal hysterectomy or combination procedures like DNC, hysteroscopy, hysteroscopic DNC, or removal of products on hysteroscopy. But always remember that there is no specific correlation between the peak systolic velocity or the blood loss in the clinical scenario. So the clinical scenario in terms of bleeding PV always supersede to whatever findings in terms of PSV that we label during our case of trial. So let's take few examples. So this was the patient. The first thing is that to assess what it is. The second thing what I am going to do is to take a panoramic view, then add a color Doppler to it, and then after adding to the color Doppler, I am going to increase the PRF so that only dominant vessel, which is either within the lesion in the endometrial cavity or the lesion adjoining to the endometrial cavity in the myometrium, is noted. So that only is seen by increasing the PRF, and I am going to take the velocity. Now in this patient, the velocity is there, PSV of 51 per centimeters per second. So let us think of what are the treatment options which are correlating with the velocities and clinical condition of the patient. So we have an expected treatment treatment in which we just follow the cases, we have methotrexate for few cases and then follow them on transfer ultrasound. We have a uterine artery embolization exclusively or along with after reduction a hysterectomy. Then we have alarming situation wherein total abdominal hysterectomy is done, or in patients where the endometrial content has an abnormal vascularity for which hysteroscopy, BNC and removal of products or placental polyps have been advocated. So what are the key features which are important from treatment option with a transmembrane color Doppler? But more than that, it is a clinical bleeding PV condition which is equally important. So let us take one example. Here there is a heterogeneity in the endometrial content, but it doesn't show any abnormal vascularity within those contents. So probably we are dealing with a non-viable products of conception within the endometrial cavity. Now this is a follow-up case where no bleeding P was noted, but here the velocities were approximately 30. There is definitely suspicion or confirmation of products of conception within the cavity with abnormal vascularity within those content. But eventually, because the velocities were low, follow-up was advised and no subsequent frequent bleeding BV or incident bleeding BV was noted. Now in this patient, you can appreciate the velocities were more than 45 centimeters per second, closer to 60. Here you can appreciate that the endometrial content has got abnormal vascularity, as well as the vascularity within those content is extending beyond the endometrial cavity into the myometrial substance, and you can appreciate that there is an enhanced myometrial vascularity which is causing disturbances as far as this patient is concerned. So for this patient, MTX with a follow-up on transmembrane ultrasound on beta HCG was done, and eventually the patient turned out to be asymptomatic in due course of time. We always should remember that if there is an increased bleeding PV or a torrential bleeding PV, even though the peak systolic velocities are low, but here in this patient they were 86, and you can appreciate that the heterogeneity within the endometrial component, as well as there is an enhanced myometrial vascularity and a branching pattern causing abnormal turbulence within that region over there, which eventually leads to uterine artery embolization, after which the patient shows regression of these signs, including the endometrial cavity as well as the myometrial zone. Always remember that whenever in case of gestational trophoblastic tumor, where we treat them, in spite of DNC and removal, on many occasions we will find that there is an abnormal enhanced myometrial vascularity starting from the endometrial cavity, which is causing a lot of turbulence. Now here in this patient, you can see that the velocities were closer to around 70-80 centimeters per second, for which uterine artery embolization was done, and eventually the bleeding PV was taken care of. Now in this patient, you can see that it's a post-preterm delivery patient where there was a substantial amount of bleeding PV. Now there is an expansion of endometrial cavity because of a homogeneously echogenic mass within the cavity, which shows abnormal vasculature within that region. But at the same time, that vasculature is extending beyond the content of the chorionic tissue into the adjoining myometrial substance. This is nothing but an enhanced myometrial vascularity, for which hysteroscopy followed by ENC hysteroscopy was the answer for this patient. Now in this patient, as compared to the previous case, you can appreciate that there is a ballooning of the cavity, little bit of more heterogeneity is visualized, the vascular branching pattern is quite obvious within the content of the endometrial cavity, but the peak systolic velocities were not that high. Those were closer to 30 centimeters per second. But in spite of the fact those velocities were low, because of the bleeding PV, because of the ballooning of the cavity, because of the mass effect caused by the chorionic tissue within the endometrial cavity, eventually the patient landed up with hysteroscopical removal followed by DNC. One more entity regarding which I want to speak is called the placental side topoblastic tumor. This placental side topoblastic tumor is basically a tumor of intermediate tropoplast. It's not a tumor of cell side topoblast. So here, traditionally, what we create in case of a gestational topoblastic disease is high levels of beta HCG. But in these patients, you will not get high levels of beta HCG. In fact, those levels could be suboptimal or even in few cases normal. But you will get raised levels of placental lactogen. Placental lactogen test on serology is quite a costly investigation. But for the same time, a proper assessment of a transvaginal ultrasound by the doctor or assisted help of MRI will solve your issue. Now this PSA